Hello, everybody. My name is Ben Worthy. I'm an academic here at Birkbeck, and I'm also the acting director of the Centre for British Politics and Public Life. Now, Lyndon Johnson's first rule of politics was learn how to count. And those of you who can count probably realise that not everybody who's here is yet here. We've got MPs on the way, and they're going to be here at approximately 6:30. So until then, I'm going to open the discussion. And then I'm going to speak with Chris Bowers here, who is one of the co-editors of the book that we're speaking about. And then when the MPs arrive, they're each going to do a five-minute perspective on where their parties are. So excuse me if we're being a little bit flexible about the programme here. This is the difficulty sometimes when you have members of Parliament speaking on a board. So we're here to discuss this book called The Alternative, and it's pretty reassuring to actually talk about alternatives. These days, we all looked rather locked into certain patterns of behaviour. On the board, we will have Lisa Nandy, who's been MP for Wigan Labour since 2010. She's been Shadow Secretary of Energy and Climate Change, and before that, Shadow Minister for Children. Alongside her will be Caroline Lucas, who is currently co-leader of the Green Party and the Greens MP for Brighton. She was previously Green leader, as you know, in the past. And John Cruddas, who's Member of Parliament for Dagenham and then Dagenham Rainham since 2001, who also, as you may know, played a significant role in the development of Labour policy before the last general election. And next to me is Chris Bowers, a writer and broadcaster. He's very interested in environmental issues. He's a Liberal Democrat councillor, and he stood to be an MP in 2010, and then again in 2015 in Brighton, interestingly enough, against Caroline Lucas, which in a spirit of kind of optimism and positivity is where this book actually came from. So just to give you a kind of introduction to this book, it's about the idea of a progressive alliance, which is the concept that parties of a progressive bent, and maybe we can discuss exactly who they are, should work together in some way, whether electorally or even in terms of governing. As you say in the book, this is often seen as a rather foreign, inverted commas, idea to British politics. But to be honest with you, when you look through the history and some of the examples in the book, actually working together is quite common. If you think of the welfare state, it was originally a Liberal idea and it was finished by the Labour Party, and it looks like it's been finished off by the Conservatives. You've actually had progressive coalitions for a long time at local government level, that area that nobody in British politics ever studies. And if you look to Wales and Scotland, you've had progressive governments as well. Looking a little more forensically at what's going on now, there's actually been all sorts of electoral pacts up and down British politics since the 1990s. You've had Sleaford, where the Greens stood down. You've had Richmond Park, where the Greens and Lib Dems worked together. And very interestingly, no problem. You've had Jeremy Corbyn hinting at a possible alliance in the Stoke Central by-election, which is taking place on Thursday. So the concept behind this book is that progressive parties can unite around progressive ideas. And again, we should probably discuss later on what these progressive ideas are. But really, ideas around cooperation, dispersing power, protecting rights, radical approaches to reform, and of course, an increased urgency due to Brexit. All sorts of different people have recently called for progressive coalitions. Everybody from Clive Lewis to Tony Blair. And if you look at it, the electoral arithmetic is key here. The Conservatives actually won a majority based on 24% of registered voters. The Greens got 1.5 million votes and one seat. And UKIP got 12.6% of the vote and one seat. But of course, there's one or two obstacles. As you well know, the first-past-the-post system creates all sorts of tribal effects. And John Curtis, the great John Curtis, has written a chapter in here where he talks about whether there is actually a potential for a progressive coalition. Being stunningly accurate, as always, he claims that 49% of the electorate are potentially progressive and 51% are not. So perhaps we can discuss and see if we can shift that figure around. And that there's no simple answer to what the British public may unite around. Perhaps questions for John and Lisa here are about the attitudes of the Labour Party. If you want a progressive coalition to work, it's the Labour Party who need to get on board with this and support it as the largest progressive party on the left. And then there's a final practical question about how would this work? Are we talking constituency level? Are we talking formal? Are we talking informal? And how might it work across the United Kingdom, given that politics looks so different in England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland? So as I've been rabbiting on, you will see that both John Cruddas, who's been MP since 2001 for Dagenham, and Lisa Nandy, who's been MP for Wigan since 2010, have both arrived. So what I'm going to do now is give each of the panel 5-7 minutes or so to introduce a perspective and topic. I'm going to then fire a few questions at them, and after then, it's over to you. I want you to make your questions polite, succinct, and difficult, if you could. So, without further ado, maybe we'll go John,
okay.
Chris, and then Lisa.
Right, can you hear me if I speak about this level? Yeah. Well, thanks for having me this evening. Sorry we're slightly late. We've just sort of ran from the vote, and I think Caroline is coming. She had another vote as well, I think.
Yes.
I'll just speak for a few minutes then. In principle, I'm very much in favour of a progressive alliance, in the sense of marshalling all of the forces against the forces of reaction, everything else being equal. That doesn't seem to be a bad idea. I think the way it was organised around a recent by-election in West London was very effective in terms of creating a civility and a cordiality in politics. Why shouldn't members of different political parties, who arguably you might well have more in common with across a political divide than you would in some within your own party, why shouldn't they work together to try and sort of alter the sort of tempo of the public conversation, try to create a more plural democratic character to our discussions, which is inclusive and acknowledges the complexity of political dilemmas rather than simply as the party line that you lock down, etc., etc. So there's also a sort of democratic element to here in terms of the culture of political parties themselves. So everything else being equal, I am in favour of the notion of a progressive alliance. And indeed, I really liked the book, The Alternative, discussed here this evening. But it seems to me as soon as you start drilling into some of the details, then we very soon get to the conversations that should be had that aren't necessarily being had around this debate to date. And that, I would suggest that we're in the early foothills of this conversation about what constitutes a progressive alliance. It seems to me it's more tactical at the moment, and I can understand that in terms of electoral arithmetic and stopping other people winning, but what is the actual footings in the ground about what constitutes an agenda for around a progressive alliance? See, to me, I look at some of the data, and it seems to me, and I will be corrected by our colleagues here, that the progressive majority that we used to talk about, and we used to talk about the split in the left vote between Liberal and Labour, and that there was within the country a progressive majority, is very much under threat. And now you talk almost about a dead heat, whereas previously there's been the assumptions, and there was when Labour was in power, actually, and Paddy Ashdown came into government to talk about some sort of a wider coalition between Liberal and Labour forces, that there is this notion there's a progressive majority in the country. Now, I would dispute that, and a lot of the data I've seen says even if there is, it is a very thin one, and it's very much under threat, and the rate of change is one way, really. So surely that says more about the decline in left thinking rather than left tactics, in terms of do we have a model to organise around? If you look around, I'll go to deeper questions. This is around the notion of what it is to be progressive, actually. If you look at, as I understand it, progressive means by definition to want an altered economic, social, political, democratic structure to move forward. Actually, the left increasingly look quite old-fashioned, somewhat nostalgic. They don't look to be the progressive forces. You could make an argument that it's the radical right that are the progressive forces and want radical transformation now rather than the left. The point I'm making is, since the post-war period, post-war social democracy has hit a wall with Reagan and Thatcher. It was offered a way out through the third way of Blair, Schroeder, Clinton. That didn't really change things that dramatically. And so the left has been in a long-term decline in terms of its electoral appeal and the deeper sense of what it's for, the character of it. What is the sense of a left model of justice today? And I don't think we can define one. And until we can define one, we shouldn't really be talking about a progressive alliance, because we're talking the cart before the horse organisationally. And I would go into the deeper questions, actually. Usually, within the Labour Party, this is seen as a liberal versus old Labour debate, if you want. A Labourist versus liberal left debate. Actually, I think it's more a debate across the broader left, and it would best be reset about a debate between the cosmopolitan and those who are more concerned with parochial, local issues. And I think that's the best way to reset this conversation, in that the left, where it has any purchase or energy, seems to be preoccupied with a cosmopolitan mindset that recognises no borders, is associated with universal truths. It has this notion of a cosmos rather than a locality, and that has the unifying sort of blend to a lot of the thinking within the book. I would point to one chapter in here by a great thinker called Jonathan Rowson, who talks about this quite in terms of the psychology of the left, and he embraces this notion of the future or progress, and I wonder if that's really of use as much as it used to, because it has a sort of deterministic sense of history unfolding and in a more progressive way, that we're moving towards this end, which is more sort of utopian and positive. Whereas the world I see now in my constituency in East London, across, I was in Stoke yesterday, it was pretty bumpy ride in terms of talking to local residents. If you look at what's happening in terms of Brexit, the right wing in this country, the alt-right, if you want, across North America, what the far right that's on the move across mainland Europe, you know, there is no great sunny uplands here about a progressive endpoint. This is tough stuff. And I think the danger is that the cosmopolitan mindset, which does dominate a lot of left thinking, is abstracting themselves from the day-to-day realities and difficulties in communities like mine and Lisa. And the left, more often than not, has very little to say in terms of an animating purpose, a sense of energy and vitality, which used to attract me, still does. But I find that the left, it's almost like the walls are coming in, the ceiling's coming down, partly because of the government, 13 years in power, partly because of the Gulf War, partly because of a load of other things. But more fundamentally, there is a deeper sense of there is no left philosophy anymore that is unifying and can appeal, and it has real depth and energy attached to it. And that's what's missing. So in end up, we can search for tactical solutions around a left coalition, a progressive alliance to fend off the right, but that's all defence. And the real issue is what are the fundamentals in terms of a new public philosophy, a sense of justice, a sense of a good society, a good life that people can live, a sense of human self-fulfillment or nourishing or flourishing. What it is to be human, that needs to re-energise the left in terms of a sense of purpose and energy. A moral critique of modern capitalism, because that's what it had out of the post-war period of social democracy coming out of the war. It did have a deep moral critique of capitalism. And we've lost that. And until we find that again, I think this is a sort of second-order debate, really. We need to find a much more fundamental sense of what is the purpose of the left within the contemporary world we inhabit, rather than one we'd like to. And I think simply abstracting into this cosmos notion of what we're attached to is just a way of running away from the day-to-day difficulties in communities like ours in terms of what the left is for. Because people will tell you they don't know what it's for anymore. And I actually find a bit of bewilderment when I try and think what the purpose of the left or Labour is today. And if I don't know, I'd make a tentative suggestion that a lot of my constituents won't know either. And really, that's what we should be doing. And we should all be working across the aisle, across political parties, to try and excavate that space, work on something. But this is tough road ahead. And anyone who thinks, right, slam dunk, here's the tablets of stone, a progressive alliance is going to have the single magic bullet through this, can forget it, because this is a much tougher story. I'm fearful we're hiding behind a lot of this debate rather than using it to run to the difficult, hard yards that we need to be inhabiting for the months and years ahead. So I've probably gone slightly further, but that's my sort of introductory pitch on this.
No, that's fantastic. And just welcome again. Here's Caroline Lucas, co-leader of the Green Party and Green MP, as you know. Okay, that's really great. Really sets things up nicely. And I think we should probably think about discussing this idea within the context of some of the changes to British politics and this idea of sort of two Englands, and before we even discuss some of the other parts of the UK. Now, over to, with us are now the three co-editors of this collection, And so over first to Chris Bowers, who is going to give the viewpoint and perspective of the Liberal Democrats.
Is this working or?
Yeah.
Yeah, good, fine. Thank you. I've always, throughout my political career, I've always wanted that to be the things to be stirred up, to be shaken up, and sort of for the, some of the crustiness to be turned on its head. I didn't quite expect it to happen the way it's been happening over the last few months with Trump and Brexit. But I guess you can't always, when you wish for something, you sometimes get it in a different form than what you want. I think we're at a frightening time at the moment. I see certain parallels. I know we overuse the Nazi era, but we have certain parallels from the late 20s and early 30s in global economics. And even things like, if you look at what Turkey was like 15 years ago, I think there's some very, very worrying things going on. And therefore, it's not just that we have an upheaval in British politics. This is both an opportunity, and I think it's an obligation, because I think there's an awful lot that's getting lost here, and there is an obligation among those people who are concerned about broader society. I'll come back to that in a second. Anybody who's been a member of a political party will have been told some form of the message, there's us and there's the rest. Yes, we do. We can agree with people from different parties in the bar. We can agree with different parties when we're in opposition together, occasionally in coalition together. But by and large, when it comes to election time, we're right and the rest are wrong. We've got to get away from that. The differences between the parties on the centre-left, if indeed we can use those terms, centre-left, because I think John makes some very good points about, does the term left mean anything these days? But the parties that we're talking about here have got to start losing some of the tribalism. And that's not aimed at any individual party. My party's as bad as any other. And in fact, if anything, in the time that Caroline, Lisa and I have been working on this idea since shortly after the 2015 general election, I would say the Greens have shown a greater willingness than Labour and the Liberal Democrats to actually drop some of the tribalism. But it's a big problem that still has to happen to a bigger extent. That's not to deny that we have differences. Let's celebrate the differences, but let's recognize also that we're up against a Conservative Party that is at the moment presenting itself something as a centrist party, a natural party of government. It can do this because of UKIP to its right, and it's presenting itself as like a natural party of government. Now, I liken the Conservative Party a bit to a bumblebee. A bumblebee should not be able to fly according to the laws of aerodynamics because its body is far too big for its wings. But because it doesn't know this, it flies nonetheless. And in many ways, this is the Conservative Party. How can you have a party with Ian Duncan Smith at one end and Ken Clark in the other? They are poles apart. And yet because they're all under the same roof, it means you only ever have one Conservative candidate in any constituency or council ward at any one time. And so they clean up while we are debating against each other. Now, I would like to get to a situation where we have every vote counting so that you can fight an election based on your own party platform. Until that happens, we've got to be smart. And we've got to learn to work with each other so that we get a better system. But as John says, it's not just about electoral tactics. We've actually got to present something that is inspiring to people. Even if your primary motivation is to get a better electoral system, what happens then? If it's a proportional system, parties have to work together. So how are parties going to work together? How are they going to unite around certain ideas? And this is why in the book, we didn't just talk about electoral tactics. Yes, there's a fair bit about electoral tactics in there, but it's also about the kind of values and policies that progressives can unite around. And you're entitled to ask the question, well, hang on a second, Labour, Greens, SNP, Plaid, maybe SDLP even. Do the Liberal Democrats belong in this group? And it would be a fair question to ask, especially after we've just spent 5 years in coalition with the Conservatives. For me, the dividing line through British politics is the dividing line between those who fundamentally care about the broader welfare of society and those who care about themselves and their own systems that nourish them. That's not to say there aren't some good people in the Conservative Party. There are good Conservatives, but the Conservative Party machine is fundamentally malign. That's not to say we shouldn't listen to why people vote UKIP. The reason why people get driven to UKIP, the reasons are very important for us to hear. The policy platform, we've got to diss. There are obviously people that from the progressive parties that you can say, do they really fit? I think everybody who's been a member of a political party will find they've said about other members of their party, am I the wrong party or are they? That is part of a broad church that every political party is. But we can't just make this electoral tactics. We've got to find a platform. We've got to find issues like, for example, housing. We need more housing. It's got to be environmentally well built, otherwise we're creating problems for ourselves later. And if it's designed for maximum livability, you solve a lot of social problems. You get kids playing in the street. You get people using cars less. There are win-win-win situations if we only embrace these things and find the areas that we actually agree on. Now, I believe that we can find an inspiring program here. For me, what's at stake here is not the rebirth of the left. That, for me, is a political concept. For me, it's the rebirth of compassionate politics. If we want there to be a compassionate offering on the table at the next general election and future elections, we have to be willing to embrace cross-party working, however the structure of that actually happens. And that's why we have to tackle the tribalism within our own parties. I've got a number of more things I could say, but I'm going to finish on a slightly odd anecdote. I was talking last week to somebody who was telling me that she was having a discussion with her husband and her son. Her son's studying politics at university, and they were having this discussion about politics, and it was getting more and more detailed and more erudite. And eventually, the woman who was telling me telling me about this story said, oh, for goodness sake, why can't we just love each other and get on? Now, okay. Oversimple, naive, and it somewhat sweeps under the carpet the suffering that makes so many of us passionate about the compassionate politics that we're advocating. But in a way, we are missing out on connecting with people the way people want to be connected with. I'm convinced there is more than 50% of people out there who want to support a compassionate platform, if only that's presented in a coherent way that is economically sound and that people think we can actually achieve. I do believe this can be done. It will not be easy, but I actually believe that we owe it to the next generation to try, because the way things are going at the moment, if we don't grasp the nettle here, I hate to think what kind of Britain our children are going to inherit. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. I hope somebody's going to cheer me up at some point soon. And next, over to Lisa Nandy, another of the co-editors of this book. As I said, she's an MP for Wigan since 2010. She's also been Shadow Secretary of State for Energy and Shadow Minister for Children. More important than all those, she's also former Birkbeck, where she did a master's as well.
It was hell.
So, Lisa, great. Over to you.
Thanks. Okay, I'm going to try. I don't think I am going to cheer us up, actually. A lot is riding on your contribution, I think, yeah, Caroline. But I'll just start by saying that Chris said to you that Caroline, Chris and I sat down in late 2015 to conceive this project, and the book came out of that conversation. Really, the two of them, I think you may already know, had stood against one another in the seat that Caroline represents in Parliament, and afterwards had had a conversation in which they said, this makes very little sense. We need to be cooperating with one another and not fighting each other. And I had come to a very similar conclusion, having gone to almost every marginal seat in the country in the run-up to the 2015 election, and seen how more often than not, I was as a Labour representative, was pitted against people from other political parties with whom I agreed on a majority of areas that we were discussing, perhaps not the means, but certainly the ends and the ambition. And there was just a growing sense for me that we were, by attacking one another, we were letting the Tories off the hook, we were losing the argument with the wider public, and we were just letting people down in towns like mine across the country who cannot cope with any more of what they've been seeing over the last few years. And actually, when we started to talk about this book, what we found we also shared was a sense of optimism. This wasn't just a project because we were all quite profoundly depressed about the outcome of the 2015 election, although we were. It was also because we all feel instinctively that this country can be better than this, and that we can do better by the millions of people who live in this country and around the world if we took a different approach. But since we did the book, and it was a great project to work on, it was difficult at times, and I'm sure these guys will tell you about it in the Q&A, but it surfaced a lot of the actual nuts and bolts conversations that John talked about, which are very, very difficult to surmount, not least the way that the electoral system pits us against one another and hinders cooperation, especially at a local level. But when we did the book, I felt particularly optimistic. And then, of course, we were campaigning in the EU referendum, and that happened. Then we had the election of President Trump. And on Monday, you may have seen, but there was an opinion poll, which I'm gonna cite. I know people are sick to death of opinion polls, but this one in particular I think is important because it is the reality of what we're facing. It showed that the Tories are now 18 points ahead of Labour. And more importantly, if you took every single person who says that they are currently intending to vote Lib Dem, Green and Labour and put them together, the Tories would still win the next general election by 8 clear percentage points. I say this not because I'm pleased about it. I say it because that is the reality of the situation that we're in. And having spent most of the 6 months in the run-up to the referendum out on the road in towns like Sunderland, Stoke, Wigan, Middlesbrough, watching people shake with anger on doorsteps while they talk to us about majority, why they wanted to leave the European Union. I have to say that having gone back to all of those communities over the last few months, I get the same sense that the polls are telling us, which that support for leaving the European Union is hardening. The idea that suddenly the polls are going to change, that we're going to find ourselves in a new universe where people wake up and realise that Boris Johnson has lied to them and that Nigel Farage never meant any of it and that everything's going to change overnight, I think is optimistic at best. So, and I say this because I think in my political party and across the progressive spectrum at the moment, there is a lot of wishful thinking. I think it's been a profound shock for a lot of people what's happened over the last couple of years. And I think there are a lot of people actually grieving for the country that they thought that they lived in and for the future that they want to build. And what I would say to that is that for all of you who feel like that, and me included, what we need now, to quote Tawny, is not self-commiseration, but a bit of cold, hard realism. Because if our response to this now is to say, well, we just renew our efforts and we get out there and we fight again with the same weapons and the same tactics and the same arguments, then what we will find is that we lose, and lose again. And I think the central question that anybody who believed like me that we should remain in the European Union, who felt passionately about that and who went out and made those arguments in the run-up to that referendum, needs to answer is, how is it that people in towns like mine in Wigan, trade unionists, lifelong trade unionists, foster carers, people who volunteer at my local asylum welcome project, how is it that people like that were voting leave in such large numbers? And I said earlier this week, something that annoyed a lot of people in my political party, that Labour's perspective is becoming very skewed away from towns like mine and the changing mood in towns like mine over the last 20 years or so, certainly since the mid-early 2000s. It's becoming skewed because the more people who join the Labour Party, who are many of them fantastic campaigners, passionate about changing the world, are disproportionately coming from cities with liberal outlooks, often homeowners with good, well-paid jobs, and their lives couldn't look or feel any different from people, my friends and neighbours in Wigan, if they tried. And if there's a risk that Labour's perspective is becoming skewed away from understanding what is happening in towns like mine, then I would say that that is even more true for the progressive movement in British politics as a whole. The last few months, I'm sure these guys on the panel probably share my frustration about it, have been profoundly depressing, given that a year and a half ago we set out to try and renew the bonds on the progressive wing of British politics. I've seen the Lib Dems adopt an approach that is strategically to take the last few remain votes that Labour may be holding on to away from the Labour Party. We've had Lib Dem activists standing outside Labour conference signing people up. We've had attacks on the Labour Party from the Lib Dems in Stoke rather than attacks on UKIP. I've seen the Greens competing for that same set of votes with the Lib Dems, so them attacking one another rather than working together. And I went into the House of Commons chamber the other day for the EU debate for the Article 50 bill, and I saw a queue of Labour MPs lining up to attack the Lib Dems, while the Tories sat back and got a free rein. I mean, some of those Tory backbenchers and the frontbenchers just quite simply couldn't believe their luck, because while we're clubbing the hell out of each other, they're getting on with whatever hellish vision of post-Brexit Britain they want to construct. And it doesn't have to be like this, is what I really think. That I felt even more strongly when we'd finished this project than when we started, that there is a majority of us across those political parties who believe in a social security system that isn't just a safety net for people in their hour of need, but is actually an enabler to enable people to live better, more fulfilling lives, an education system that isn't just about investing in people as economic units, but as Caroline rightly said when we launched this book, that enables people to live larger, richer, more meaningful lives, that nobody in this country should be held back by the want of a decent home or a decent income, by loneliness or lack of self-confidence or mental ill health. And all of us very, very clearly believe in an economy that invests in people and works for us and not us for it. And in the last few months, I think one of the best things that I've seen come out of the most depressing events around the world is this phenomenon of people clubbing together to stand up for the rights of refugees and EU nationals who are here, the campaign to build bridges, not walls, to retain our internationalist outlook, to care about what happens to people in other countries and to champion their rights here and within our own political parties. But what we can't afford then for this to become is just a debate that tries to reduce this to a tactic about winning the next general election. And that's one of the reasons, not the only reason, but it's one of the reasons why I'm very sceptical about how much emphasis in this debate is on changing the electoral system. Because one of the things that the electoral system that we currently have does is it forces parties like mine to try to cross some of those divisions in British politics that currently exist. You have people in my political party that range from seats like David Lammy's to seats like mine, his seat where people voted overwhelmingly to remain, my seat where people voted overwhelmingly to leave, and culturally the attitude in society in those seats is very, very different. But both of those groups of people have consistently voted Labour, they subscribe to Labour values, and they agree with the majority of what we say. And if changing the electoral system is a way for us to stop trying to reach both of those groups of people, trying to persuade people, trying to bring people together, then I don't support it. This cannot be a strategy about speaking for the 48% or the 52% or any other percentage that you care to pick in between, not least because I feel that the 48% and the 52% aren't actually the percentages that people think. There are a large minority of people on either side of that debate who felt passionately about remaining in the EU. But I think much more importantly than that, there is a sensible, decent, committed majority, many of whom weighed up those votes carefully, who could have gone either way in that debate. And somehow, as progressive politicians, we have to win them, we have to convince them, persuade them, and that starts by listening to us. And what I wanted to say to you most of all is that I think, you know, many people in my party who've taken this approach, that you have to understand what is happening amongst the people who came out in the rain on the 23rd of June in Wigan and queued to vote Leave, even though they've consistently voted Labour, and I know, because I know them, that they hold progressive values, just like people in towns across America who went out and voted for Donald Trump and put him in the White House. We have to stop shouting at them and start to understand what it is that lies behind this phenomena. Labour's predicament at the moment, pulled to pieces by this Brexit debate, is actually the country's predicament. There is no future for this country unless we find a way on the progressive wing of politics to speak for the sensible, decent, committed majority. And that's why I say we have to stop shouting. Well, it's absolutely right to take to the streets and stand up for the values that we have and stick up for people who are under attack from people like Donald Trump and the values that he holds. But we have to do more than that. We have to do the politics of this, which is seeking to understand what lies behind this phenomena and how it is that so many people in towns like mine could come out and vote for something like Brexit in June. If there's one thing that I have really understood in the last 2 years, it's that progress is not inevitable. And that if you want to change this country, you don't just go out and fight for it. You have to go out and listen and learn and work for it. Caroline said something when we were doing the book about none of us having the monopoly on wisdom. And I think that's absolutely right. And that is why I am completely committed to the idea that you work together as progressive politicians, whichever political party you happen to have made your home, in order to change things. But if being progressive means anything to me, it means that. It means seeking to listen and learn from other people. It means seeking to negotiate shared challenges in the interests of the many and not the few. And it means believing that nobody is unreachable or irredeemable, and that we have to speak for the majority. Just lastly, I would just say this. I don't think I've been through as painful a political experience as the EU referendum, and I hope I won't again. I found myself pitted against members of my own family, friends, neighbours, people that I would count as comrades and colleagues, fundamentally different people, people who should be on our side but weren't. I'd felt a little of that when I was campaigning in Scotland during the Scottish independence referendum, and thought, never again do I want to be on the other side of an argument from people who I fundamentally share a political outlook with, but somehow find myself divided by this question. And if we are going to speak for the majority of the country again, then it's our approach that has to change. And that's why, despite all of the difficulties that I've just outlined between Labour and the Lib Dems and the Greens at the moment, I feel that this is even more important than ever. If we are so arrogant as to believe that we are right and they are wrong, whether that's other political parties or the electorate, then we will repeat this cycle over and over again. And that pain that I felt in the EU referendum will be just the beginning. I believe that we can change this, but to change that, we have to change ourselves. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Lisa. And finally, the view from the Green Party. Caroline.
Thanks. Well, I was worried before I got here that we were going to all agree, and I don't think we are, so that's always interesting. And I'm so sorry I didn't hear what John said. My sense of direction obviously isn't as good as these two, because it took me longer to get here than it took them. But I don't know what John said, but if it was along the lines let's work out what we're for before we start talking about the tactics, if that's not reducing it too narrowly, then I want to say yes and. In other words, of course, a progressive alliance or any kind of plotting out how we respond to the extraordinary times that we're living in has got to be more than just some electoral alliance that's cooked up behind closed doors and is then kind of presented. I mean, that is an appalling vision, and it's not one that we're talking about. And yes, of course, a progressive alliance for what? Talking to other parties and finding common ground for what? I agree that that has to be part of the debate. It's not just about electoral tactics. It is about narratives, it's about stories, it's about a vision, and it's about how we bring people with us along that journey. But it's also, crucially, about something that's compelling. The referendum, if it taught us anything, was that facts alone don't swing majorities, that you have to speak to people's hearts as well as their heads. And, you know, many of us on the Remain side, I think, thought that if we just kind of explained it a bit more clearly and had the leaflet that was a little bit more dramatic, then that would be the thing that was going to change people's minds, because it was logically coherent and we thought we had a good case to make. None of that cut through compared to something as powerful as the lines around taking back control, something that just went straight to people's guts. And I think on the left, we've got a lot to learn about how we frame some of the debates that we want to have in terms of something that is far more resonant. But I guess the bit that I might take issue with, having kind of reduced John's argument down to an absurd concept, I'm now going to attack it. Because if we're saying that we're not going to explore how we overhaul our corrupt, redundant, ridiculous electoral system until we've worked out what it's for, then that to me is a wrong answer as well. that there are very good reasons for saying it is an outrage that this government is doing what it is doing on the basis of 24% of the eligible vote, and that many more people would be involved and feel included in our democracy if they felt that their vote counted. Indeed, that is what the referendum told us, that many more people went out to vote, not least because, for the first time in a generation, they were living in a place where their vote would count, because every vote counted in that referendum in a way that under first past the post, they simply don't. And I agree with everything that Lisa has said about bringing the country back together and how you do that. And there are many, many levels and layers of complexity in that. But I don't think it's too... too far out to say that that part of that solution is also about the electoral system. It's about enabling people to have their voice heard and their vote heard, not just when the government deigns to give them a referendum, but at every single election. So to me, this issue about what we do about our broken democracy in this country is a cause in its own right, and it runs alongside the parallel discussion about the values of the left and how and what vision we have and how we are going to talk to people in this new environment that we find ourselves in. But if we think we've got to do that before we tackle the issues around the electoral system, that is the bit that I would take issue with, because getting better, more compassionate politics in place is massively urgent. And I want to posit that although there may be very significant differences between us on some of the best strategies to do that, I don't think it's unreasonable to say that there are values that we can posit that unite broadly people of the left or centre-left, however you want to describe it, which are different and separate from the values that traditionally have bound the Conservative Party together and now UKIP and God knows what else Aaron Banks is planning up the road as well. In other words, I think that there is a starting point for this debate. We're not starting with a blank piece of paper. We know that those of us on the left want to see a far more redistributive economic system. We know that we find it an outrage that tax breaks for the rich are being paid for on the backs of some of the poorest people. We know that the climate crisis is a real and urgent crisis, and we need a massive investment in green energy and energy efficiency. We know that that would create hundreds of thousands of new jobs as well. It would tackle fuel poverty. It would tackle the climate crisis. It would create jobs. It's a win-win. There are a huge number of issues, and not issues, a huge number of values which are expressed in some of those kinds of policies that I think we can agree on now. And let's use that as a starting point rather than saying that until we've got every dot, what do you do, every I dotted and every T crossed, we don't actually find ways of working together. Because I've sat on so many panels, many of them organised by the wonderful organisation Compass, so many panels where we have batted backwards and forwards what we agree about, what we disagree about, how we're going to, you know, build this kind of common analysis. And yet all of that goes completely out the window come election day, and we just fight the hell out of each other as we always do. The Tories sail through the middle and, you know, the rest is as we know it. So it seems to me that we do have to be smarter about our electoral system, even as we are talking about these other the values and the way of expressing those and trying to face up to some of the biggest challenges that we face today. And when Lisa said, she didn't exactly put it like this way. It's great actually sitting here misquoting what my panelists have said, but since I've started, I'll say it anyway. She more or less said, given that if you put the progressive vote together, the numbers who voted Green, Labour, Lib Dem, then it didn't outvote the Tories, so that doesn't get us much further anyway, does it? I don't think that's too unfair a representation of what you said. But I would argue that what that analysis misses is the fact of the thousands, the hundreds of thousands of people, the millions of people who aren't voting at all because they're so pissed off with the whole system because they know their vote doesn't count. I don't think you can know what people would vote under a fairer voting system by simply trying to extrapolate what people have voted for in the past, because a lot of people vote tactically. They vote for what they like least when it comes to, what they hate least when it comes to first past the post. And also a whole load of people just don't bother voting at all because they know their vote doesn't count. So I genuinely believe that electoral reform is a massive part of opening the door to the kind of politics that we need to see. It's not the only thing that needs to be done, obviously. But to me, it is a crucial part of it. And partly because the politics that we are talking about is so urgent. I'm coming from the Green Party, and for me, the thing that keeps me awake at night is the accelerating climate crisis and the fact that right now we have a government that is doing exactly the opposite of what is needed. In other words, giving tax breaks to fracking, to yet more fossil fuel extraction at exactly the time that we know that we need to be leaving 80% of fossil fuel reserves in the ground if we're to have any hope of avoiding dangerous climate change. So the agenda is urgent. We have an utterly unresponsive democratic system. We have a system that is putting people off politics altogether. Lisa was saying, why were people like foster carers in Wigan voting to leave the EU? And I wouldn't presume to answer that question. I don't know. But what I do know from some of the people that I've spoken to is that actually a substantial number of people were voting to leave, not because of anything intrinsic about the European Union itself, but because of what it stood for. Because, frankly, the Remain campaign ran such a sod-awful campaign that it looked like yet more of the elitists. I mean, yeah. I say that as a member, I was part of it. Yeah, yeah. and it was an appalling campaign. And it didn't speak to people's realities. I remember so strongly at one point, one of the prominent Remain campaigners, saying we should have a campaign slogan of "Don't risk it," and nobody thought to point out to him that actually many people's lives right now there is nothing left to risk. It doesn't matter because people are so desperate. They are so desperate that the hopes for their kids having a better life than they have had, their hopes for having a meaningful job, their hopes for having security so they feel that their house genuinely is a home that they can really build a life on rather than just a temporary roof over their head if they're lucky before they get sanctioned by the job centre or whatever else. And that sense of, that just epitomised it for me when he said, this idea of don't risk it is a really good idea, as if we've got so much that we're risking, and actually not recognising the desperation that is out there. So this new politics that we're talking about absolutely has to be addressing that desperation. But I would just surmise that between us, we could come up with some pretty good ways of doing that. And a bigger problem for us is the fact that even if we came up with a manifesto that we could all agree on, which I frankly, perhaps in my naivety believe that we could, so what if the system is so much banked against us that we are still fighting one another in first past the post elections? So I guess I would conclude by saying that I think we have a responsibility to explore how best we might be able to work together to get a fairer voting system. I absolutely would say that isn't about doing anything behind closed doors. I very much like the model of open primaries where even the Tories explored that for a while until it delivered Sarah Wollaston, such an independent-minded and good Tory MP, that they got slightly scared of what they'd just kind of put into place. But essentially open primaries being where you actually have a debate in the community about who you think is going to be best placed to be up against a kind of regressive Tory. That, to me, is a very open way of doing it. It's one way of doing it, right through the whole spectrum of just an informal agreement about where you might target resources at a next election. What a progressive alliance, or I prefer the plural, progressive alliances look like in practice depends entirely on the constituency that we're talking about. It's probably just a handful of marginals at the next election that could make a difference. But alongside all of the debates about the narrative, about the way in which we try and wrest back the agenda from the right and the far right, alongside that, I would just argue that overhauling our broken, horrendous, exclusive democracy has to be part of that solution.
Fantastic. Thank you. Just before I hand over to you, I'm going to use my prerogative to ask a quick question. One of the points you make in the book is about moving across party lines, but I'm now going to ask each of the panellists a very party-orientated question. Because I want to ask each of them, what are the advantages and obstacles for Progressive Alliance from the viewpoint of your own party? And I thought I'd start with the Lib Dems, then ask the Greens, and then move to Labour, because, as you say a number of times in the book, Labour's the key to this, and getting Labour on board will make it work or make it fail. And I've just got two quotes from two members of the Labour Party. So when people say to me, you should form a progressive alliance with the Lib Dems, I just ask, what is progressive about them? That's Jeremy Corbyn in December. And then John McDonnell in December, I don't see the Lib Dems as a progressive force. They certainly weren't progressive when they were in coalition. I just think the electorate also would be concerned that parties were stitching up elections privately. I don't think that's the way forward. The way forward is to support and vote for the Labour Party. Now, there has been...
Let's go home now.
Someone has slightly changed their tune in the last few weeks with the Stoke Central by-election. There was some talk of some cooperation, mainly, as you were saying, defensively, to stop Paul Nuttall rather than kind of offensively to push a progressive alliance. So if I can just ask Lib Dems first, then the Greens, and then Labour, what are the advantages and obstacles for making this thing work?
Yeah, on that progressive one, I mean, when Caroline and I first had a discussion about doing something, you know, that turned out to be the book, I actually floated that with a column on Lib Dem Voice, which is a website for debate among people who are either members of the Lib Dems or at least sort of friendly towards the Lib Dem ethos. And I got so much response. Who says Labour are progressive? I think John's point earlier on about we need to define what progressive is actually reasonable. We make an attempt in the book. And in a way, what we believe is progressive, George Osborne used to call his budgets progressive. So we've got to, we chose that word as the least of the evils in many ways, but, you know, because we needed a word to unite around there. But the word is not without its problems. Where do we benefit? Well, if you look at various seats of the last election, Andrew George in St Ives, Norman Baker in Lewis, Stephen Lloyd in Eastbourne, Mike Thornton in Eastleigh, these were people who lost their Lib Dem seats when the Conservatives, where the Conservatives' vote remained static. And they lost it because people who had voted Lib Dem before, mainly Labour and Greens, went back to Labour and Greens. Now, I don't fundamentally blame them for that. There's only so many elections you can expect people to vote tactically before they feel that they've completely lost their identity. But that is what this electoral system does. I tell you one disadvantage for us about progressive cooperation, and it's very real now. We're getting a lot of Conservatives from the international business-orientated wing who are sort of saying, yeah, I might vote Liberal Democrat next time because I'm so cheesed off with what Theresa May is doing towards Brexit. Now, I'm a little worried about this, I have to say, because I'm very much a social liberal who considers myself on the progressive wing of British politics, as we're using the term tonight. And I don't want us to sort of move away from our cooperation with Labour and the Greens for fear of frightening off people like that. But that is at the moment the political reality. And again, all political parties, if they get people saying, well, I'll vote for you because, takes a very, very strong conviction to say, well, it's nice of you to want to vote for us, but actually, if that's what you believe, don't, because that's not what we stand for. And, you know, that is what's happening with us at the moment. A lot of internationalist soft Tories are showing an interest in us. And it's both flattering and worrying from my perspective.
Very interesting, this idea that if you work together, you might kind of dilute your message or brand. Caroline?
God, where to start? well, the advantages for the Greens of progressive alliances is, from our perspective, the opportunity of pushing forward on electoral reform. And before John and Lisa might pour cold water on that, I just want to say that, for example, today I was at an all-party group on electoral reform that was set up in December by Chuckaramuna and Jonathan Reynolds, two Labour Party MPs. When I went to the forming meeting, the kind of the original meeting to kind of form the all-party group, it was absolutely packed. I was with Labour MPs. I was invited to speak at a Labour Party fringe meeting on electoral reform, absolutely packed. And I do think that there is a growing recognition within a growing number of people in Labour, not necessarily represented with us right now, that no matter who their leader is, the chances of them winning the next election with an outright majority are vanishingly small. It is not going to happen. I don't know anybody who genuinely thinks that they're suddenly going to make this happen. And therefore, for the very first time, having some kind of discussion about electoral alliances is in Labour's electoral interests, and that has never been the case before. Before, we've been trying to plead to on their, you know, their better conscience or making all kinds of other cases for it. But now I think it's absolutely clear that when you add in constituency boundary changes and you add in what happened in Scotland, where I think Labour got around 24% of the vote, but just one seat, you know, if you add those together, Labour is not going to be a government at the next election on its own. So that's that. The prize for us is the idea that reality is sinking in, and therefore there might be greater openness than there has been in the past to the concept of working to achieve a change in the electoral system. The obstacles to that are, obviously the idea that from Labour's perspective, I guess, can look like a sign of weakness, and that's why Jeremy will say things like he says in public. Just to absolutely add that no one's talking about stitching up privately. That's exactly not what we're talking about, and we make that very clear in the book. But there is, I guess, still some people that also think that one last push can transform Labour's fortunes, and they will win a majority at the next election. I don't know how many people think that, but perhaps some do. I think a bigger problem is a lack of trust, and I think that really is a big problem. And that probably goes for all of the relationships between our different parties, because whenever you're talking, you know, about one of the other parties, people will give you a million reasons why you can't possibly trust them. And I think there are ways of addressing that. And I think, for example, in Wales, Plaid, Lib Dems and Green got very close at the last Welsh Assembly elections to having a formal agreement as to who would stand where. And they got as far as having a memorandum of understanding that had two signatures on, and then at the last minute, for reasons not fully understood, the Lib Dems didn't go along with it. But that got to that point, and the idea that you could have a memorandum of understanding which actually codifies who's going to do what would be one way of having that kind of insurance policy of knowing that people would do what they said they were going to do. That comes at the kind of one end of the spectrum of trust. Trust is obviously much better nurtured and generated through working together and just, you know, whether it's a campaign to keep a local hospital open or indeed through the Remain campaign or whatever, there have been better relations that have happened as a result of that. For example, in Brighton, which can often be as tribal as they come, in the referendum campaign for the very first time, we had a joint leaflet between the Greens, Labour and Lib Dems, and so we had all three photos on it, and we had quotes from all of us, and basically the message of the leaflet was some things are more important than party politics, and we agreed who was going to, you know, deliver it where. And that might sound just like so obvious, of course you would do that, but believe me, it was absolutely revolutionary given the politics at the time in Brighton. So it can be done, and we can build trust. And I guess the last thing I would just say in terms of maybe advantages is that when the Greens took the decision they took in Richmond, which was not to stand and to support the candidate best placed to displace Zach, which in that case was a Lib Dem, what was interesting about that was the way in which the public responded to it, and what was so good about it, and tribute to Lisa for her role in you know, trying to persuade Labour to do the same, was that we had a packed meeting where people came out to understand what was going on, and on the doorstep, Greens still went out on the doorstep and gathered data for local elections and, you know, did their 20-mile-an-hour surveys, and also explained that, in a sense, they weren't standing down, they were standing up for a different kind of politics. And I think that idea was something that people really appreciated, and, you know, and you got that sense from people saying, thank God, you know, there's people are being a little bit smarter given the you know, particular realities of the election at that point. And I think we shouldn't underestimate that there is an appetite for a different kind of politics out there.
Great. And if I just ask Lisa and then John for the view of the Labour Party, and perhaps to just discriminate slightly, the views between the leadership and perhaps, if you're aware of it, any views within the party at its grassroots about this sort of idea. Lisa?
Yeah, I'm definitely not getting into that. what I would say, though, first of all, is that this is, I mean, obviously this is quite a controversial thing to talk about within the Labour Party, but what I have increasingly understood is that this is quite difficult for all political parties, probably more difficult for Labour, but actually, well, there's a chapter in this book that we very purposely went out and did, and Chris did a lot of the groundwork in getting that together, where we looked for examples of local cooperation, where people had managed to govern locally around the UK with other political parties, and we found, well, you read it for yourselves, but it was pretty difficult. And I think the conclusion of one of the Labour councillors who'd gone into coalition with the Lib Dems after governing with them and probably doing some very good things for quite a long time was that he was going to spend the rest of his life trying to wipe them off the face of the earth. So this is quite difficult to do, and We all three of us went to the three political party conferences and talked about this, and we got a fantastic response from the vast majority of the people, but we did also get significant pushback from a minority of people within all of our own political parties who'd come to those events precisely to make that point. So this is not easy to do, and it's also, as Chris said, defining what you mean by progressive is quite difficult to start with, and we had a go in the book, but you will always get people, as I was reminded of at their conferences, about Iraq and about the way that we'd treated people in the benefit system when we were in government and so on and so forth. You know, Lib Dems in coalition came up a lot. The experience of the Greens in local government came up sometimes. So there is a difficulty with that. There's also a difficulty about what you mean by progressive alliance. And for me, this very much doesn't mean trying to merge all the political parties into one. For me, actually, Labour in government benefited enormously, and the country did, from the Lib Dems reminding us not to be so careless about people's civil liberties, just as I think the country benefited from Labour telling the Lib Dems in coalition not to be careless about people's economic freedom and the choices that they're able to make because of that. So the differences between us, I think, are important. But what I'm looking for, really, is a much more adult debate where we treat each other not as the primary enemy, but often as allies in a much larger battle. And the Goldsmith example in Richmond, I thought was, I mean, it didn't work out so well for me, but, you know, it worked out well as a whole. Clive Lewis, Johnny Reynolds and I had said that Labour should consider not standing a candidate in that election because it was only a few months since Zach Goldsmith had run the nastiest, most racially divisive campaign I've ever seen in mainstream British politics in my lifetime. And in my view, and theirs, it was absolutely essential that we sent a very, very strong message, not just to him, but to David Cameron, who used the dispatch box of the House of Commons to do that, and to anybody else who's considering trying to bring that sort of politics into the mainstream of British politics, that they are not welcome in the House of Commons. I'm really, really grateful to Caroline's party for standing aside, because I think it was the right thing to do. But like she says, the interesting thing was how not just the electorate responded, but Labour Party members. It was an incredibly controversial decision locally for the Labour Party not to decide to stand a candidate. And actually, our candidate at that election, who was very good and campaigned very hard, ended up polling fewer votes than we have members in Richmond. So actually, I think this tells you something about the way that the public has got there, but perhaps the political parties haven't quite yet. And the big benefit to me of cooperating with other progressive politicians is quite simply that we are losing the argument, and I don't think that we need to. Not just the EU referendum, but human rights, immigration, the economy, social security. When I go to towns where people absolutely fundamentally share our commitment to social justice and what I would call Labour values, progressive values, I find that on all of those areas people are moving away from us. And I think we can win them back, but we can't win them back if we're too busy clubbing the hell out of each other and not working together to advance the argument. People are crying out in this country for a much more adult conversation. I think they're desperate to hear it, and that I think we need to give it to them.
I've got a slightly different take on this, I'm afraid. Contrary to what Caroline said, I am totally in favour of PR. I actually have been a long time, partly because of my long-standing belief that it's those with least skin in the game, if you want, materially, who have less purchase on the political system, have got most to lose because of the way the present political system is set up. So swing voters in marginal seats have long-term had the arm lock around the political system, and that has to be unpacked in the interest, because it's the working classes that fall off the edge. That's always been my view. That was my view when Labour was in power, when a lot of the people who are now converting to PR within Labour is usually occurs when we're out of power. But my view was always in power that we were building the system into a few swing voters in marginal seats, and we're building up long-term resentments about my team, Labour, and the government, which actually are playing out now with Brexit, UKIP, etc., etc. These festering discontents that were never dealt with or confronted because the electoral system redirects politicians away from them. And that seems to be so unarguable. It means that in principle, ethically, you cannot do anything other than support PR. So Lisa and I would disagree about that. But it's the same reason, actually, that I have a problem with the electoral alliance, the Progressive Alliance, because if you sit in constituencies like mine, alongside the degradation of the planet that you were talking about, with the degradation of work, the growing inequality, the sense of progress, A, needs to be unpacked a bit. And second, the danger with the Progressive Alliance as presently constituted is a bit of a preoccupation of the middle classes. And again, the danger is it's set up to the exclusion of people I represent in working class communities who have no skin in the game in terms of the present debate. I'll give you an example. There is quite a debate around some elements in the Labour Party. There was always a thing called the progressive dilemma on the left, which David Markwin used to talk about, how you reconcile the middle class intellectual traditions with the traditional working class base. There's a big debate in the Labour Party now. Actually, it's not really a debate. It's becoming a self-evident belief system whereby the working class are disappearing anyway. So that dilemma is disappearing through automation, the changes in the world of work. So the future base of the left is amongst an urban, educated, networked youth. People like Paul Mason, in his new book, Post-Capitalism, he literally celebrates this, and our future is Romania, blah, 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 blah. The future of that progressive alliance is within a very segmented part of the electoral landscape. And actually, to me, that will re-engineer far-right, the great moving right show in this country, and play into the hands of more pernicious far-right forces. So that's partly, and I wasn't really going to get into that, but that's my dilemma about the way this progressive alliance is constituted at the moment. It is a plaything among a specific community politically at the expense of those who should be front and centre in any enduring reset of the political conversation, right? So now, going back to the pros and cons of electoral reform, well, it's always been a minority sport in Labour, especially when we're in power. Because it's usually seen as a tactical calculation about getting into power rather than a deeper question of democracy, citizenship, the character of our electoral system itself. The benefits to Labour, even though we won't go there, are that it is sort of countercultural to who we are at the moment. It demonstrates a certain agility and creativity. It's a big idea that we should embrace at a time when we're a bit of an ideas-free zone, blah, 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 blah. So self-evident it should be going there. We won't do because, you know, flip over all the arguments I've just said. We are an ideas free zone. No, we probably won't do. And we see, actually, unfortunately, some of the people who have embraced it in the past, as soon as you get anywhere near the electorate, they game all that out and then they jettison things that they said were a primary part of their belief system. So that, in turn, compounds the problems with people's perceptions of politicians in and of themselves. So you either stick with this thing or you don't. That seems to me where you start with. You stick through thin and thin, actually, within Labour, and you wait till it will will out, because it will do. Because all of this are sort of, a lot of the stuff that we see, the resentments, they are. And I agree totally with Caroline about those people who stepped up, because their vote had significance in the Brexit debate. For the first time, actually, people outside of the very segmented sort of calculus of how politics is constructed in this country, they knew they could kick up a bit of dust, smack the table over, their vote mattered, and good for them. You know, they sort of got, I mean, strangely enough, I welcome what they did in terms of that. I don't like the outcome, but I like the sort of the detonator effect of that in terms of forcing people to wake up. I don't like the collateral damage in terms of the outcome. But that seems to me to be a very democratic element to this, which is never really addressed in terms of the conversation, which should be actually front and centre of what a progressive alliance would look like. My fear is it's a debate that's occurring without those who have most to gain from it. And actually, those who are not, if they're not involved in it, will mean that this will just be a gift to much more pernicious forces.
Great. Thank you. Well, with that intro, it's over to you now. So, if I can just ask you to stick your hand up with your questions. Oh, I've not even finished my sentence. And I'll take three questions at a time. You first.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much for being here. It's really an inspiration to hear you and see you talk and bring this Progressive Alliance forward. My name is Thomas Schurz. I study here. I'm a politics, philosophy, history student. My question is, you talked a lot about the direction you want to go to, towards this progress. And I wanted to hear your take, your position on what I'm going to call the Swiss model. It could also be called the Republican model, the assembly regime model, where there's an assembly in every town and people are truly sovereign in the sense that they ratify the law. I'm not suggesting they should write it. But so I'd like to hear your point on this, which might be called proper democracy in a way. That's my radical opinion. I also have a question specifically to Carolyn Lucas and the ex-shadow energy chancellor about thorium and molten salt reactors. Whether you think that is not greener than, for example, solar or windmills, and why the Green Party refuses technologies like this, which, you know, are actually very green and potentially need all the arguments.
If I can stop you there, we might. I might leave it to Caroline to answer that question later, if that's okay, because I don't really know what it means, and but in the sense that it's a very specific question for you, if that's okay. The lady there with the white collar and the black jumper. Yes. Yes.
Okay. The tiny one first, which is, am I right in thinking that some of the parties actually have in their constitution that they're obliged to pitch a candidate wherever, despite the kind of productive. The other is that I'm old enough to remember an attempt, although I can't remember when it was. It was possibly 92 or 87, when Bruce Kent, who was the chair of CND, and a truly wonderful person, had a campaign which was simply called Get Them Out. And I went round offering people posters that were just an A4 divided, diagonal, red, yes. Yellow. And my toes curled because that says, let's lead to Brexit. Right, but I don't want to go and mess it with him. So is there a figure who can cut across all of this stuff, another Bruce Kent, possibly David Attenborough, I don't know, some sort of safe, and just push everybody into getting them out. And then we can discuss whether it's...
Move the Tories out.
Yes.
Yeah. And you mean then the Tories? Perfect. And the gentleman in the blue and white striped jumper there.
Hi, thanks to the panel for this evening. Lots of reference to the electoral reform, first past the post, PR. Last year's referendum overshadowed a more recent referendum, which was the alternative vote. I'm really surprised, actually, that wasn't referenced at any point, but I'd really like comments from the panel 6 years down the line on that vote, which saw, I think, 42% turnout, 68% saying no thank you. Just in light of what each of you have said this evening around the voting system and electoral reform, as I say, a reflection on that referendum would be interesting.
So just to summarise the three questions, firstly, what's the end product of this sort of progressive alliance? Could we even look at these, what you call kind of super devolved or total devolved models, a bit like the Swiss cantons or elsewhere? Secondly, who's going to do it? Is it going to be Tony Blair? And three, what about the referendum that we all forgot about? Reflections on the voting reform referendum of 2011. Anybody like to go first? Maybe I'll go Caroline and then along. Caroline?
Well done. Thank you. Okay, so on working backwards, on the alternative vote, I mean, I didn't reference it because I don't think it was a proportional system. And I know plenty of people who are in favour of proportional representation who voted against it precisely because in some circumstances it can actually lead to less proportionate outcomes. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't a helpful thing. It was a lovely example of an alliance, though, because I got together with Douglas Carswell, and that's a sentence I don't often say, but I got together with Douglas Carswell to attempt to put other options on the ballot paper. So when the legislation was going through Parliament, we were trying to get a genuine electoral reformed system as part of the choices that were being put before the people, and we didn't succeed in doing so, unfortunately. What I would say in terms of what we need to do next is not have another referendum on voting systems and not indeed to have major discussions about, you know, list systems versus AMS versus AV plus versus all the rest of it. Just turns people off. What I do think we need is a commitment, the big goal, if you like, and John will tell me how unrealistic this is, but nonetheless, a big goal for me would be about how you would get PR in the next Labour Party manifesto so that then you would have the
what we're calling for tonight's purposes, the Progressive Parties all going into the next election with a commitment to electoral reform. And I don't think it's that... It's going to be a struggle. But John McDonnell has now done a very public U-turn on electoral reform, I think, and said he now supports it. Even Jeremy has said in some circumstances, as long as there's a link to a constituency, then he wouldn't necessarily be against it. You've got Unite the Union around now in favour of it. The TUC is looking at it. So it does feel as if perhaps the tide is turning. The second one, David Attenborough riding to our rescue. I loved out David Attenborough, but I haven't seen him yet being very willing to stand up and speak out on the political side of things. And I don't think he would. And I don't know that that is even the right question to be asking in a sense, because I think what we need is actually something that gives power back to people. And the idea that we can just have somebody riding in on a white charger to sort it out, I just don't think is going to work anymore. If it ever did, and perhaps that links to the question about proper democracy. I mean, I don't know enough about how the Swiss system works, but if part of the question at least is around genuine devolution and genuinely giving power back to local and even regional level, then absolutely that has to be part of the kind of constitutional reforms we're talking about here. I mean, the way in which the lifeblood of councils has been utterly sucked out of them by this centralising government, under the auspices, of course, of localism. I mean, the irony of it is multiple. But essentially, the way in which the government's managed to outsource all the responsibility for the hideous cuts that are about to hit very soon as councils now are going through their budget-setting process, it's been so clever in a way, because everyone's now fighting the council because they want to, you know, defend adult social care against cuts to youth services, and, you know, it's councillors in the frame. You know, councillors are just being left with the most awful, awful decisions because all of the money is being cut by central government. So to the extent that proper devolution, real bottom-up imagining together along the kind of Porto Alegre type style of people coming together to decide how they want to spend budgets and so forth is absolutely part of the answer. And I'll be very happy to talk about thorium afterwards.
Lisa?
Just to pick up on the theme that Caroline was developing there around power. So I think just to try and sort of take on this question about, you know, who can persuade people and how do we do it? I think there's a reason that take back control became the defining slogan of the referendum campaign, because it didn't just convince people of something, it actually caught a mood. In the run-up to the 2015 election, when I was campaigning in marginal seats all over the country, not just people who are absolutely being shafted by this government, but a much, much broader set of people who, many of whom are managing okay, but are increasingly worried about the future. The overriding sense that I just got from the vast majority of the country was one of real anxiety and insecurity about what the future would look like, about what the prospects for their kids would be, about whether things would be okay tomorrow. And I think take back control really did catch a mood in this country, which is the things that people really care about. Quite often in the last 7 years since I've been in Parliament, I haven't even seen them on the political agenda. So when I step off the train in Wigan on a Wednesday night, it's like stepping back into a completely different world from the world that I inhabit in Westminster. And so the idea that somebody can come in and somehow make a rational case and convince people that life is different without actually having an answer to how we're going to put power back into people's hands and give them control over the things that give meaning to their lives, whether it's good quality work that you care about, that you're proud about, that gives you an income, that enables you to live a decent life and see your kids and spend time with your elderly parents and not have to worry about what's going to happen to them in the future, to be able to go to those shared institutions in your community that give your community character and meaning, to know that people aren't going to be building all over the green belt that helps to protect the identity of the place where you were born and brought up and have always lived and brought your kids up in. These are the sorts of things that actually I think this is what John was getting at the beginning, about how we didn't really have a meaningful story for people about what we stand for and what this country should look like in the future. And that, to me, if we don't do this, the risk is that the only people who do this are the likes of UKIP, and what they say is you just turn the clock back to a time when everything was wonderful. But it wasn't. You know, if you're my dad and you came to this country as an Indian immigrant in the 1970s, trying to be married to a white woman and being beaten up when you went into pubs and being told that no blacks, no Irish and no dogs. No, it wasn't wonderful. For someone like me growing up in that era, it wouldn't have been wonderful. For most women in my constituency, for most men who worked down the mines doing dangerous, difficult, dirty work, it wasn't wonderful. But what there was security. And with that security came dignity and status and a place in a community. And so it's really important for me, actually, that this debate that we're having doesn't collapse into what John was saying is this sort of fairly middle-class, city-centric agenda, not because I disagree with that agenda, but because I think that it misses the point somehow. And the issue for me is less about who spreads the message and much more about what that message is. And that's where I think that we have something to learn from people who live in towns like mine, who can tell us quite honestly where we've got it wrong. It's not that people have been disconnected from politics, it's that politics has become fundamentally disconnected from people. And that's, you know, where I really do agree with Caroline is this point about people coming out during the EU referendum to vote because they knew that it would make a difference. Like John says, it was a detonator. It was their last chance to get us to sit up and listen. Not because their lives are terrible, not because they've got nothing left to lose, but actually because they still do have something left to lose. They've seen the way it's gone in the last 20, 30 years, and they are determined to protect the things that they still have. And they were saying to us, you are going to listen. And they weren't wrong, were they? Because I've never seen an effect like that in politics in my lifetime. It's that it shook Westminster and Whitehall to the core, and now everybody is trying to deal with this. And that this for me is the real battle. It's power in this country. It's not just redistribution of wealth, it's redistribution of voice and influence and confidence and income and connectedness and all of those things that really matter to all of us that enable us to have dignified lives. And most, you know, there are a lot of people who currently hold power in this country who don't want to let go of it. And that's what unites all of us on this panel, I think, is that we want to let go of it and we want them to let go of it too. And this is the real battle in British politics. And this goes to your question, absolutely. I don't know anything about the Swiss model, but what I do know is that if we don't give people real power back over the things that matter in their own lives, then that sort of festering discontent that John talked about is going to explode. We saw a bit of it with the Scottish referendum, we saw a bit of it with Brexit, but I think there's more to come unless we get to grips with it.
Chris? I lived in Switzerland for 2 years. I, if you know, an organisation called the Environmental Transport Association. I brought it over because it's a Swiss model that I brought to this country. It's The direct democracy, the idea of a referendum every 6 weeks, you have a referendum. Do you know the turnout? It's between about 20-25%. People get referendumed out. And, you know, I think we're slightly missing a point here about, and this is also relevant to the AV referendum question, people in this country are not that interested in politics. They're interested in politics at election times, they're interested in the sort of, like you support the football team that plays in red or blue, you know, a bit like that in terms of politics. What people really do care about is issues around their local area. You look at all the people who've been successful getting into local politics. It's because there's been, you know, some child that's very nearly been killed. We hope it's very nearly been killed as opposed to killed. And therefore, there becomes a campaign for, let's get a zebra crossing there. Let's slow the traffic down. Let's get safe routes to schools or whatever. And that's what people are interested in. And that's where there's a wonderful article last Friday's Guardian about how the Greens are doing really well in some of Labour's heartlands. Not because they're the Greens, but because they've got a group of people who've gone round and asked what the concerns are. And the concerns are to do with homelessness, rent arrears and threatened homelessness. What we need to do is to get less worried about politics and more into the issues that get people. And if we do that, if we form a voice to do with what I call compassionate politics, people will get interested in politics because they'll be inspired by it. The AV referendum was a terrible system, but it didn't interest people. I found it very moving when Lisa talks about, you know, her family background in Wigan. And when she talks about we must give people a voice, yes, this has got to come up from the ground up. That's why, much as I was a great admirer of Bruce Kent, don't please get into the idea of individuals. There are plenty of admirable individuals at every level of society, but we don't want, you know, your irritation with Tony Blair came because people invested far too much hope in one guy, exactly, which he could never live up to. I mean, I'm as critical of Blair as everybody else, but, you know, he could never live up to that. We've got to get away from investing hope in individuals and investing hope into people at the grassroots. But for that very reason, Lisa, when you talk about voice, we must have equality of voice. We have equality of gender. We have equality of sexual orientation. We have equality of racial heritage. We have equality, or we're striving for equality of able-bodied as against disabled. We have to have equality of voice, and that must mean that everybody's voice at elections has to be heard and has equal value. And that's why, for all my admiration of you, I have to disagree fundamentally with your unwillingness to embrace some form of PR system. I would actually like to have Labour, Lib Dems and Greens putting in their manifesto, not proportional representation, use the term equality of voice by all means, but put a system in, put additional member systems, so it's a system that we can all agree on and get on with it. Because really, what we need to do is to get people into local issues, not have votes every 6 weeks like they have in Switzerland, but just trust that the local representatives can get on with things, and that when they come up for their mandate being renewed, everybody's vote does actually count. That, I think, is the way towards it, rather than assuming that politics is going to solve the problem. No, it's people. We just need the political structures to enable it to happen.
I very much agree with the last two points you made. One about Tony Blair looking for the messiah sort of figure, in which people are prone to do in the darkest of environments. And second, the PR thing in opposition to Lisa. On the AEV one, though, I mean, I know everyone trashes it now. I actually saw it at the time as a bit of a stepping stone into a debate. I mean, the trouble is, it didn't work at all. It was a disaster, actually. And the interesting thing is, a lot of the people who worked on the successful Brexit campaign were incubated in the anti-AEV campaign and the Taxpayers Alliance. So they moved around different organisations, fine-tuning these skills that they were nurturing at the time. And they've had a succession of victories, not just electoral victories, but also altering the texture of the public conversation. And they shouldn't be underestimated. And they're very, very sophisticated in what they do. And that was one of the lessons that should have been learned from the AV campaign, which was not. The other one is where a group of politicians cobbled together a system and then presented to the people who, funnily enough, are bewildered by what is we're trying to achieve out of something. And you should have gone for a clearer principle, fundamental position or proposition, and just organised around it for the long term rather than sort of go all in. Even though at the time I bought with the tactics of going into something that could have reset or set a base camp for future developments, but proved not to be. I very much agree around this devolution thing. I shouldn't really say this, but before the last election I was responsible for Labour's manifesto. Now, you could say that didn't work too well, and I'd agree it didn't work too well, but the two things we did try and slide in, one was a commitment to PR, and that was thrown out very, very early. And another was a much more robust approach to devolution, trying to use questions of power as a new metric in the conversation rather than just financial transfers. And it didn't work because the Labour Party is still addicted to sort of small transfers of money as the solution to politics rather than much more deeper concession of power and democracy. And that was quite a sort of difficult experience in terms of the culture when you clash against, you push into the culture of a party which is so embedded in terms of an inability to reimagine its role, especially when you have these festering, the wheels are turning around the festering sense in amongst many communities about a total a canyon building between them and those who purport to oversee them and make decisions on their behalf. And we should have been much more agile on that. I would suggest, even though Caroline suggests that Unite have now embraced PR, that might have something to do with them gaming out some future Workers' Party and needing a changed electoral system for order to get a foothold in that. Maybe that's what John McDonald's thinking about as well, but I don't want to go too far into this conversation. But the point being, there are different motives in this game rather than the purer fundamental proposition that we should be organising around is around citizenship and democracy in terms of every right for every person in the country, which should be sort of axiomatic in terms of a modern, vibrant constitution.
I'm not sure you're allowed to throw hints out like that and then not.
It's also, I didn't mean to.
Okay, this side, your turn now. The gentleman in the blue shirt.
I want to come back to the point of stitching up the vote, which I think John McDonnell said. As a Labour Party member, I'm quite happy never to see a Tory government again. But isn't it the case that some people want to vote UKIP and Conservative?
Absolutely.
So is it democratic to limit the choice of who people can vote for?
Great. And a red tie there?
Chris, you touched on this, and Lucy, you as well. You said that Chris, 51% of the UK was progressive, and Lucy, you said that the summation of all progressive parties wouldn't go above the Tories. So how do we change that? How do we make Britain more progressive? And if you'd like me to slide in a slight extra thing, in Scotland, the turnout in the Scottish Parliament elections are actually only around 55%, and in Japan, which uses AMS as well, the turnout is also 55%. So better electoral systems do not necessarily equal better turnout. So how would you suggest making the British public more interested in politics? Thank you very much.
Perfect. And one more question. Right at the back, the lady right at the back.
Hi, I'm Climate Jordan from Main Breaks International. I just want to pick up on the slogan, take back control, which to me seems completely inaccurate because we didn't have control. If we're talking about people power, which I think really is what people want, they want the equality of voice that's just been referenced, then we can't say that we've had that at all in this country when we look at the last 16 general elections, because of those 16, 13 of those, the majority of the public have voted for parties to the left of the Tories, so the progressives, effectively. So, weirdly enough, of those 16 times, 9 times the Tories got into power. So that clearly isn't a voting system that's representing what the people want at all. So what I'd like to understand from the panel, and maybe particularly most respectfully from Lisa, how is this Progressive Alliance going to get us anywhere if it's not about getting real democracy? Because otherwise we're just going to be having to cobble together every election. And cooperation is brilliant, and we need to be going towards that anyway.
Okay, if I can just quickly summarise. In a sense, all the questions are around a similar theme. Is PR democratic or undemocratic? John Curtis, has said there's 49% progressives versus 51% non-progressives. How do we get around that? And then your point about the electoral system. Only one government in the 20th century actually won more than 50% of the vote, and they were led by Birkbeck's Prime Minister, Ramsay MacDonald. Just drop that in there, sorry. How can this work within a first-past-the-post system? At least temporarily, it will have to work within a first-past-the-post system before you change to PR. And maybe there's a kind of broader question there about how do you imagine this working? You know, what you offer in the book different ways of making this work formally or informally. So how's it going to happen? And can it really happen in a first-past-the-post system? And I'll start with John.
Oh, shit, you got me there. I was thinking you were going to go the same way as last time. How does the present... the present system is such a roadblock to actually change it, because those who have power in it have achieved it on the basis of the present system. So how do you unlock this prisoner's dilemma, which is what it is? You do it through nurturing conversations, widening, deepening a conversation about the fundamental illegitimacy of it, because it denies people a role and equality within the system. You can talk as much as you want about the equality, but if there's a fundamental inequality in terms of who controls the political architecture in the country, then you cannot. Then that fundamentally undermines your bona fides in terms of a wider agenda around economic and social change. That's how I get. So these issues of, these issues of democracy are not second order or liberal issues. They are fundamental to a deeper sense of equality, economically and socially. So you just have to go out there. That's why, despite the criticisms I had, well, they weren't criticisms, they were sort of contributions around the book. The book in and of itself as a material, as a resource, as a tool to widen this conversation is absolutely key. And there should be not one or two books, there should be a whole sort of group of them, so that you can sort of change the character of the public conversation. That is what is needed to be done. I agree with you. I mean, that gets back to the point that was made at the back there. The gentleman's point there, if people vote for him, Well, you have to respect the legitimacy of people voting. That seems to be the axiomatic, given everything I've just said, you know. We had it, for example, and the reason why I got really interested in this, to tell you the truth, we had in our borough, we had 12 BNP councillors on the local authority, right, out of 51. Right? Now, to me, that was because that was a reaction to the political system, the first pass of the post system, disenfranchising huge swathes of the electoral landscape. And we're reaping this now, right? So then to deny further the legitimacy of those votes which are in protest at that, be they from UKIP or BNP or whatever, under a PR system, seems to me totally incoherent in terms of the fundamental propositions that you're putting forward in terms of the reasons why you need to change the system. So you have to take, you have to suck it up, you know, the negative things that might not exactly subscribe to your views. I'll give you an example. Look, we were Irish, Catholic, Labour, working class, a bit of a job lot, right? And you were, Labour's your team that you were with, usually a source of frustration, occasionally a source of hope, but that's your team, you know, that's how I sort of grew up. I'm slightly more plural in my approach nowadays, but I still have those sort of attachments. But I also respect that not everyone has lived quite, they really didn't want everyone to live and grow up the way I did. So I also respect people coming at this from different perspectives, and I also respect the way that is reflected in the ballot box. And that has to be a hallmark of the electoral and democratic process. That does not mean you want to change it to actually give people more ability to register their personal points and grievances at the election, irrespective of that challenges your own, you know, political DNA.
Maybe if I can focus for the three book editors on two of the questions, which was how would this work? And I was rather astonished with John Curtis's chapter when he pointed out that it was almost exactly the same percentage as who voted Remain, who were also the kind of percentage who will vote for a Progressive Alliance. It's 48-49%. So how do you win back that 49%, more than the 49%?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of elements to that. Curtis was working on the basis of research that he did. He didn't allow for who's representing the argument. If you've got somebody who represents an argument impressively, does that actually increase the attractiveness of the idea that you're testing? I actually believe that there could be a progressive majority, but we have to get our act together to make it credible. In terms of stitching up the vote, well, the vote's stitched up already. I mean, this is the point that we're making under First Past the Post. And all the arguments that I've heard over my lifetime, oh, it produces strong governments. Well, if that was ever true, it's not true now. And therefore, my ethical dilemma here is does the end justify the means in terms of, you know, working towards a better voting system? But also, it's wrong to think that cross-party cooperation has to mean standing down candidates. It made sense, and I'm delighted the Greens did it in Richmond Park, but it doesn't have to mean that every time. It could mean what I term smart targeting, where you do have all parties putting up a candidate, but where, you know, one party maybe puts a lot of its effort into one particular seat, while in a neighbouring seat, another party puts a lot of its effort in. So you're not depriving the electorate of choices, but you're being smart about the way you go about your politics. So there are different ways of doing that one. Can I just talk about the business about turnout, making politics better? I do believe that people vote more if they're inspired by an idea. And I'm actually starting, this is a personal thing rather than a Lib Dem thing, I've started to get interested in the idea of compulsory voting. I've never been particularly keen on it because it's felt like a bit of a cop-out, but for work, I spend 2.5 weeks every year in Australia. And while I was in Australia last month, the outgoing US ambassador to Australia gave an interview in which he was asked, well, is there anything you'd recommend from Australia that you would take back to America? And he said, well, I would actually now recommend compulsory voting, whereas I wouldn't when I came here 4 years ago. It actually allows the everybody to engage. You can have much better conversations with 18, 19-year-old Australians than, on average, 18, 19-year-old Britons about politics. It's because they're forced to engage with the issues. And I was given another reason, which I hadn't thought of, actually, and that is the amount of effort political parties spend getting the vote out, which could be spent on making their arguments. So although it seems like a draconian step, And I'm not totally convinced about this. I'm throwing it out in, because we're a university, with an idea to throw out there. But I'm becoming more and more convinced that this is something that needs a greater attention thrown at it. And that might also be another answer. I mean, it rang alarm bells when John talked about, this is very much a preoccupation of the middle classes, because that's what Labour said in the 70s and 80s about the environment. And it worried me then, because I found myself thinking, yes, it may be only the middle classes who are interested, but it's the people at the bottom who will drop off when the environmental reality really starts to bite. And it's people at the bottom who are dropping off because the political system doesn't actually cater for people. So in a way, I would like to get a system where we all are engaged and where if people have to vote, not totally advocating this, but then we have to listen to them. We have to listen to all the people that don't vote at the moment, and you can't get the Tories having their form of gerrymandering by their voter registration scheme, which is only going to benefit the people who are actually going to vote Conservative.
Caroline?
I've got so little to add. I'm so sorry.
No,
I mean, I agree with what John was saying about PR and mostly with Chris about what he said. I mean, I think his idea about compulsory voting, I mean, it's something that I've always said before, you know, if we can't inspire people to go out and vote, then that reflects badly on politicians and they ought to fix that rather than trying to fix it at the other end. But what you've said tonight is quite interesting. And it will be thought about. I just do think that people will vote, as Chris said, by what inspires them. And we just haven't had a very inspiring politics for quite a long time. And you know, sometimes when you go back and you look at speeches from days gone by, when people somehow just, I don't know, just had the courage of their convictions and were less worried about focus groups and just connected with people and used some social capital and political capital to say what they believed. And it's interesting when we kind of look back and think of those politicians that we respect now, even if we don't agree with what they said, it is the kind of the Robin Cooks of the world and others who, Shirley Williams, people like that, they just said what they believed. I don't say that I agree with them, but one had a respect for them because you really recognise that was actually, there was some integrity there, which I think politics has lost.
Lisa, anything to add?
I don't know. Try and find some integrity and have a go answering the question. I think, I agree with some of this, but obviously there are some clear differences. Let me try and deal with this issue about PR, because this is something that we came back to over and over again when we were co-editing the book, as you might imagine. And firstly, I suppose, what I would say is that we specifically rejected the term Progressive Alliance as the title, because one of the things that we make a point of doing within the book is exploring different forms of cooperation between progressive politicians and people who support them. And the reason for that is that you can go all the way from mergers, which I think I'm right in saying none of us are advocating, all the way through to pacts at different elections with a whole host of different issues in between. And actually, I'd still take the view that the differences between political parties are very important, and that the Lib Dems, the Greens and Labour give voice to different priorities in British politics, and that it's important that those priorities and concerns are heard. But the reason that I have a difficulty with the preoccupation with the electoral system within this debate is not because I'm opposed to PR. I can see, I think probably as clearly as many of you here in this room and a number of people on the panel, that it is a nonsense that under the current electoral system that we have, there are millions of people who vote for political parties that have virtually no representation in national politics at all. And it feels to me that that is a situation that is increasingly unsustainable. But I also have a concern about PR as the panacea for all of that, is that there are an increasing number of people, I think, on the progressive wing of British politics who think that simply by changing the electoral system, you can go off and you can stand up for the values that you agree with, and you can fight and fight again. And as I said at the beginning, and you will lose and lose again, unless you're prepared to reach out to people with whom you are fundamentally losing the argument, but who, in my view, share many of the progressive values that we have and try and persuade them. And I think there's something more going on, actually. I think there is a fundamental disconnect between my wing of progressive left politics and the people that I represent in Wigan and that John represents in Dagenham. I think this is growing. I think it's grown incredibly since I was a child growing up in the Northwest in the 1980s, and I think it's got more and more profound and more difficult to ignore. I don't think that changing an electoral system actually solves the problem that we've got. In the end, we change the electoral system tomorrow, which we can't, we're not in government, but leave that aside. We change the electoral system tomorrow, and what we get is 82 UKIP MPs in Parliament. Now, I am not opposed to that. I think that is it would be a very, very awful thing to witness, but it is also, if you're a Democrat, it's also quite an obvious result from what you are, from your values. But it underlines my point, doesn't it, that we have to start winning the argument with people. And I think one of the questions at the beginning was about why is it then so many people don't agree with us? How do we start convincing people that these progressive values are the right one? I think it is partly about the fact that we need to talk much more about the issues that people care about rather than the issues that we care about. I think there is a point, going back to the comments about Blair, that you need to have people who are capable of communicating it and inspiring the trust and the optimism that Caroline was talking about. But I think you also have to think about who benefits from some of these things. So I'll just give you one very brief example, climate change. When I was the Shadow Energy and Climate Change Secretary, first thing that I did was get out and about around the country and talk to people about how they felt about climate change. And in towns like mine, quite often the response that came back was that what climate change meant to people was either that they were losing their job or that their energy bill was going up. Now, there is a reason for that, and it's not because they don't care that the planet's burning. In fact, you know, if we'd managed in government to formulate an industrial strategy that actually invested in clean energy and created those clean energy jobs in towns like mine, where people have lost jobs in the fossil fuel industry, perhaps it would have been a very different story. If we'd found a way of paying for some of those changes and that investment that didn't disproportionately hit the poorest households, perhaps it would be a very different story. But there is a reason why people feel like this, and it's not because they're terrible people. It's because the impact on them is different. And this goes fundamentally back to my point about power. It's not just about making votes count, because in the end, what I hear time and time again, and I heard it during the AV referendum, is whoever I vote for, one of you gets in. And the point is that we've got to be different. We're not just an opposition, we're meant to be an alternative. And so far, that is the thing that I think all of us are failing to convince people that we are. And that's why I say I'm not opposed to some of the principles around PR, and I think it's an important debate to have, and we purposely had it in the book. But if that is the only debate, as it's largely been tonight, then there is a reason that we're not inspiring people, and it's not going to change.
OK, I'm going to take two quick questions and then offer anybody on the panel who wants to make a comment, because you heard it here first, MPs and councillors are extraordinarily hardworking, so I don't want to keep them any longer than they need be. Gentleman there in the white shirt and the tie.
It's a question, I suppose, about the content of the alliance and what sort of principles can be agreed on. I mean, what I don't understand is how we can talk about a progressive alliance between political parties that gives up on an existing political alliance with our brethren in Europe. I don't understand how we can talk about compassion and empathy for others within a broader society of people, of humans, living different backgrounds, living different lives, when we believe dividing our broad European society, which we already have, on nationalist lines. I didn't understand how there can ever be a successful alliance with the left, which accepts the most significant political division of the post-war era as a given. It strikes me as an inherent conceptual dishonesty to talk about building bridges on the one hand when you're allowing another one to burn. And is that not more of the same kind of expedient, soulless politics that we're supposedly trying to transcend when we're talking about integrity, honesty, and raising people up?
Okay, and I'm just, in the name of equality and justice, I'm going to take one question from this side. Gentleman there in the glasses with the bib.
It's a what when question, and it's to do with what happens when people who believed they were taking back control discover that they haven't taken that and that it wasn't enough to have a good message. I've worked for years with Bruce Kent, and I think that the get them out has turned into Trump's drain the swamp and lock her up. And the next round of messages that the media will be prepared to convey, and we can only work with messages that the media is prepared to convey, is going to be lock them up, drain the swamp. It's going to be much more negative. Unless there is something positive to show as a result of any voting, why would anybody, whatever the system we come up with, vote for another alternative? They think they voted for one now, and I believe that they are going to be in for a very rude awakening. And what message do we give, and how do we get it across, that there are real alternatives if the media are not with us? There are not enough of us to go around every doorstep on the country.
Great, two great questions. If I can just explain something about the book. Actually, there is a reasonable kind of interesting working definition of what is a progressive in there. So I can hand over to one of the editors to explain that, and then maybe give everybody 1 minute on the question there, which is kind of a negative and a positive. What are we going to do in the new politics in which we find ourselves, where people think they've already got an alternative? How are we going to persuade them of the alternative? And perhaps if I could ask each of you, just as a final thought, what would you like to see happen next? So anybody like to go first?
Can I go first?
Absolutely, Lisa, yeah.
Okay, I was just going to pick up on this point over here, because I think it's a really important thing to have thrown into the debate, a bit like a hand grenade. The first thing I want to say is that I'm not pretending that this is in any way easy. I am one of the members of Parliament who voted to accept the outcome of the referendum and to trigger Article 50, despite the fact that I campaigned for Remain and that I believe that it is a fundamental mistake for the UK and for the people that I represent. Now, these are not easy things, but what I don't accept is that therefore, on my point of view, is cowardice, because the divisions that you talked about that we are fostering, these divisions are already real. I think we are at the moment, it feels like this country is incredibly divided. I feel like I spend half of the week, Monday to Wednesday, down in London, in a world that is fundamentally disconnected from the world that I live in and bring up my baby in Wigan. I like both groups of people. I understand where they're coming from, but they don't understand where each other are coming from. And over the last year, they've stopped listening to one another at all. So if we're going to heal these divisions, then it requires a complete rethink of how we do it. And I would just pose to you something that probably won't go down very well here, but I'm going to say it anyway. If you were having this conversation in a working man's club in my constituency, one of the things that people would put back to you about this is, how can it possibly be that most of the conversation we've had here is about votes counting and real democracy, and yet the argument from this very same group of people seems to be that you block the outcome of the referendum? And that, you know, it seems to me that there are some really difficult divisions here, and the only way that you chart a course through this is by respecting people on both sides of that debate. I don't mean that this means you split the difference with people like Nigel Farage. What I mean is that there are sensible, decent people on both sides of this Brexit divide. Referendums are binary. They force you to pick choices, and they push people into black and white positions when the reality is in shades of grey. And our job as progressive politicians is to find a common voice and a vision for Britain in a global world that can speak for people on both sides of that divide. My view is that the decision that was put to people was about leaving the EU or not. It wasn't about leaving Europe, and it certainly wasn't about turning our back on the world. And I say this to you not as wishful thinking, but because actually I had these conversations with people in workplaces and on doorsteps and on street stalls all over the country during the referendum. I went to visit the Nissan factory and listened to workers there, listened to constituents of mine. And the vast majority of people that I listened to who ended up voting leave were not voting to turn their back on the world. world. And what I would say to you is there is a common, there is a way through this, but it will only start if we start by respecting one another and listening to one another. And at the moment, what I see in British politics is a lot too much shouting and not enough listening. I don't think people believed him for a minute. We had people coming up to us on the street in the 6 months run up to the referendum saying, this 350 million or whatever it is, it's not real, is it? And this is the hard truth about what happened during the referendum campaign, is that I don't believe that the vast majority of the country were taken in by those lies. I don't think they trust Boris Johnson one inch in places like Wigan or Sunderland or Stoke. To be honest, every time David Cameron or George Osborne popped up, it was a huge problem. Every time Boris Johnson and Nigel Farage popped up, it was a huge problem for them. I think people saw through it, but actually there was something much more fundamental, much deeper going on there. They were absolutely determined that we would listen. And if the first thing that we do is turn around and say, well, we said you could have a referendum, but actually you're wrong. The best thing that we do is we prove to them that they were absolutely right. They said we weren't listening and we're still not. We've got to get a grip of this, but it can't mean closing our ears to what's going on in the majority of the country.
If I could just... Caroline?
Yeah. Well, I'm certainly in favour of listening to people, but I don't think that the question that was put in the referendum gave the answer to what kind of Brexit we're going for. And I do think that is a real issue. I don't think those people, well, I can't say this, I'm not in Wigan, but I don't think many of the people that I know who voted to leave were in that vote saying that they wanted to be out of the single market, the customs union, ending any of the kind of the social and environmental protections that we have as part of Europe. Maybe some were, but I really would struggle to believe that the vast majority were. And that's why I think it is reasonable to be saying that it is right to stand up to a government that has morphed what was a small majority in favour of leaving the EU into what is, in Theresa May's mind, this massive mandate to turn your back on every single aspect of the European Union. And so Lisa and I just have different ways of interpreting that. But when it comes to... Sorry?
Well, because that wasn't the vote. So the vote
that we had to leave, and we're
was
not...
whether we're triggering Article 50. But the next vote that we have is about the actual deal that is on the table. And that genuinely, I really agree with everything that you just said about people. You know, the feeling that I get from people who voted leave and continue to back leave is that the details of that... they would much rather that we went away and put a deal to the British people and voted on it in Parliament, negotiated it in Parliament, and made sure that we got that right. And I totally agree with you. It doesn't mean giving carte blanche to people like Theresa May to go off and create this hellish vision of bargain basement Britain.
Well, I just think that is what's happened.
That's not the same as saying, you know what, you voted to leave, you thought about it, you came to that conclusion, we said you could have a referendum and we've changed our minds because you're wrong.
But I don't think...
Right.
Well, all I'm disagreeing with you about is that is what those of us who did not vote to trigger Article 50 were saying, because by voting not to trigger Article 50 at that point, we were not saying we are not coming out of the EU, we were not saying we are disregarding the outcome of the referendum, we were saying that there is still not clarity as to what kind of Brexit we are going for, and if it is the one that Theresa May is setting out with all of the damage that that's going to cause to precisely the people that you're talking about, then I don't think it's responsible to simply give her that white flag, which is what I think happened in that vote. But the wider issue that is demonstrated by this debate is, you know, what is it that unites us? What is it that divides us? To come back to kind of the question that was originally posed. And for me, I mean, it's quite interesting. Within the Green Party, we've been having a discussion about whether we call these things progressive alliances or electoral alliances. And actually, the majority in my party prefer the line electoral alliances, because it's clearer what we're talking about, because what the Green Party is behind, rather than necessarily me when I'm co-editing this book, is about a one-off arrangement at the next general election in order to get PR. And I think if you're clear about that as an instrument, then in a sense, what then gets layered on top of that in different constituencies, whether that might be about if there's enough interest in a particular constituency to be fighting also against a hospital closure or about some other things that are more resonant on the doorstep, then that is appropriately decided at a local level. But I think precisely because of the kind of debate that Lisa and I have just had, the idea that you're going to somehow arrange this at the national level and shoehorn everybody into this definition of what we've decided progressive is, I think we've just demonstrated that that isn't going to work. But that doesn't mean that the fundamental premise of the book is wrong, I don't think. I think it just means that one is more realistic about how you are going to get the change that we need to see. And just, in a sense, we've already answered it, but that last question about, you know, what's going to happen, what, when, I think there is going to be massive anger. And that is another reason that I think this debate is so important about how expectations are managed, how we go out and do that listening that all of us have been talking about tonight right now, because otherwise, in 2 years' time, I genuinely fear, or two or three or whatever it's going to take, but I genuinely fear for the anger and the level of disillusionment that is going to set in at that point if we don't do something very different very soon.
If I just ask Chris and then John for any final thoughts.
OK, first of all, the progressive definition is page 9, Roman numerals of the book. You can buy the book as you leave. I agree with Lisa that we have to listen to people. I actually still believe that Brexit could unravel and we might end up not leaving. I'm not saying it's likely, but I think it is still possible. But I will take no comfort from that. And I say that as a Liberal Democrat and a dyed-in-the-wool pro-European. I will take no comfort for that if it happens and the people who voted to leave have not been heard, because that will just create all sorts of social problems for later on. I also agree with Lisa that proportional representation is not the be-all and end-all. But one of the fundamental principles that we put into practice when we were going through this book was this has to be a movement from the grassroots upwards, not dictated down from the top down. And therefore, we have to give people equality of voice. And a proportional voting system will be so enabling. We cannot continue in a supposedly mature democracy to have 47 million people on the national electoral register and a general election is decided by about 100,000. That is fundamentally wrong. But I agree, it's not everything. We have to inspire people so that they actually say, do you know, politics, I used to think politics was a lousy game. But, you know, I think things are happening. And we will do that with policies and with ideas and with values, not with political systems. My only problem with all that, I want it driven from the grassroots, but every time I push it locally, I come up against the tribalism. Mm. And that is the problem. That's why when I give my little introduction at the beginning of all these meetings, I say we have to oppose the tribalism. We have to get people thinking about what unites us across party boundaries rather than what divides us. Because one final thought here, I actually believe there will be some form of realignment to the left of the Conservatives. My fear is that it will be a realignment of some social democrats, economic liberals, and the liberal conservatives who are sort of business and international orientation. And that will be an alternative to the conservatives. And that you will lose all possible attempts at representing the people who most need the political classes to represent them. The alternative is for Labour, Lib Dems and Greens, for all our old-fashionedness and for all what John says about the changing realities in politics. We actually need to form some kind of compassionate movement that is credible, that inspires people, and that lost somewhere in the middle of it gives equal voice to people at elections.
OK, I'll just be very, very quick, because those two questions, I think, get to the real core of these issues here. I agree, when the rubber hits the road or when the shakedown kicks in, this is going to get really, really ugly, and that sense of grievance is going to be ratcheted up. My problem, though, is, and I very much respect your sort of worldview, sir, where you're coming from, as a sort of a provider of that cosmopolitan outlook that denied the importance of countries or nations within this debate, and you abstracted a lot from it towards this sort of cosmos, this universal sort of agenda. I fear that mixture of that shakedown and the left regressing into that sort of cosmopolitanism means that when this gets really lively, it gets much, much worse. Because the danger is we then seem to have a left sentiment that actually belittles those things that people think are significant in their lives. And this is a real danger. It is usually seen as being nostalgic. Well, nostalgic means to comes from the Greek nostos and algos, which means homesickness, right? A search for home and belonging. And if we are seen as seeing that those things have no significance or belittling people on the basis of a profound sense of loss and alienation because that life that they were told they could have and were promised by politicians or believed they wanted is gone. And all we've got left is this very vague, abstract notion of a cosmic union, then this is going to get really, really ugly. And it is a sense of duty and obligation for us to inhabit a space which is not easily redefined by a movement to the far right on the basis of those terms of debate. Because if those are the terms of debate down the road, then this is going to get a very dark place. On that point...
Okay, everybody, I'll leave you with two quotes. One is from Winston Churchill. There's only one thing worse than having allies, he said, after the Yalta conference, and that's having no allies at all. And the second quote is Martin Luther King. Things always seem impossible until they happen. I want to say a big thank you to all our panel. MPs, councillors are extraordinarily busy people, and it's amazing that you all made 2 hours to come here and talk to everybody. So I want to give them a big round of applause and say also thank you to you. Thank you. Thank you so much. This is how busy they are. Thank you so much, Caroline.
No, thank you.
That was interesting. No, thank you so much, John. Thank you very much.